I'm going to teach what happened to Jesus on his trial, and I'm going to do it through the harmony of the Matthew's, Mark, Luke, and John. You know, all four of them are pretty much saying the same thing, but it's just like when you see an accident, if a policeman goes to four different people, he's going to get four different views. But if you take all four views, then you got a better picture of what happened. Because this person might leave something out, but this person saw it. So that's why they have four Gospels, and they pretty much say the same. But some of them don't say this, where the other one does say it. So I'm going to be going back and forth. I hope y'all can stay with me. That's why you got all the scriptures in your hands right there. Try to leave them in order as I go, so you won't get confused. We're going to continue with John 18, verse 24. It says, Niannas had sent him bound unto the high priest. Now they still have Jesus bound. Those of you who remember last week, you know, he was arrested and all that. So they still have him bound here. And they still haven't told him why he was arrested. But anyway, he's still in the trial, and they're still trying to pin something on him. And we're going to see as we go, they're finding it kind of hard to do. But they're to send him to another place to continue the trial. And the trial is still at night, which I told you last week. It was illegal to have a trial at nighttime. So we're going to go to continue this trial. We're going to go to Mark chapter 14. I'm going to read verse 53 and 55. And they led Jesus away to the high priest. And with him were assembled all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes. Verse 55. And the chief priests and all the council sought for a witness against Jesus to put him to death, and found none. So we can see here, we obviously don't see him following Deuteronomy chapter 25, where it talks about giving a fair trial. These religious leaders here are not doing that at all. The whole high council was there trying to find evidence against him so they could put him to death, but they couldn't find any. So now we go to Matthew 26, 59 to continue. It says, Now the chief priests and elders and all the council sought false witness against Jesus to put him to death. Again, they're going against the scriptures and the laws of God. They're just adding another illegal act to what they've been doing. Right here, one of the Ten Commandments, Exodus 20:16. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Right there, they're ranking one of the Ten Commandments. Because now they're trying to find false witnesses to testify against Jesus. Deuteronomy chapter 19, verses 18 and 19. If the witness be a false witness and hath testified falsely against his brother, then shall ye do unto him as he hath thought to have done unto his brother. So shalt thou put the evil away from among you. So what he's saying, right? What this verse is saying, if you have someone that's a false witness, or whatever he was false witnessing about to put a man to death, well, if he's found to be false, he's going to get what the man he was trying to accuse. You understand? Whatever he was trying to accuse him of, and if it was to put him to death, well, this false witness was going to be put to death for being a false witness. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And that's what they were doing here.
It comes back on him?
Yeah, it comes back on him. Now back to Mark 14, verses 56 through 59. For many bear false witness against him, but their witnesses agreed not together. And there arose certain and bear false witness against him, saying, We heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and within 3 days I will build another made without hands. Now we have a witness here saying that Jesus said that he was going to destroy the temple. All right? This is what this witness is saying. Now in Matthew 26, verse 61, it says, This fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days. Now we have two witnesses. One is saying that he was going to destroy it, and the other witness is saying that he said he was able to destroy it. There's two different things there. Now if he said, I will destroy it, okay, they got something. But just to say, I'm able to do it, but doesn't do it. You understand? That doesn't hold anything. But what we're showing here is they got two witnesses, two false witnesses, and their witnessing doesn't agree with each other. In verse 56 of Mark 14, but their witness agreed not together. Mark 15:59, it says, but neither so did their witness agree together. So right here saying their witnesses, their two witnesses they had, they didn't agree with each other. Yeah. Now,
first witness, he says, I will destroy it, but the other one says, I'm able to.
That he was able to destroy it. Yeah. Now, again, is one of them telling them the truth? No. Neither one's telling them the truth. John 2:19. Jesus answered and said unto them, talking to the people, destroy this temple. He's talking to them. Destroy this temple in 3 days, and I will rise it up. That's what Jesus said. He didn't say, I will or I'm able. What he said was, you destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will rise it up. So they thought they had a charge against him, but it fell through. Now, if you had a judge who heard an accuser say, destroy this temple. Now, this is a witness, and you're talking to a judge, and you tell this judge that he said he will or is able to destroy this temple and in 3 days raise it up again. Now, the judge, now it took 46 years to build this temple. 46 years. Now, if a witness goes before a judge and says, he said he'd raise it up, he'd build it again in 3 days. Now, either the judge is going to look at this witness as being an idiot, or he's going to look at Jesus as being an idiot. No, I mean, come on. It took 46 years to build it, and they're saying that he said he could rebuild it in 3 days. You know, now the judge is going to look at that like, come on. And plus, that's not enough to put somebody to death. That's not enough. In Mark chapter 14, verses 60 and 61, and the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, answerest thou nothing? What is it which these witnesses against thee? But he held his peace and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said unto him, art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? Now, Jesus right here said he's not answering him. Well, the reason he's not answering him, because back in John 18:23, which we read, Jesus said, if I have spoken evil, bear witness of the evil. Jesus told him, if I've done something, then tell me. They still haven't been able to prove nothing on him. They've arrested him. He's on trial. And they haven't been able to prove nothing on him. So now he's like, I'm not going to say anything else. This is what I've said to you. You're unable to show it. So Jesus is going to say, that's it. I'm not even going to pay attention anymore. Everything's illegal that they're doing. Plus, it was prophesied in the Old Testament. Isaiah 53:7. Speaking about Jesus right here. He was oppressed. He was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep before his shearers is dumb. So he opened not his mouth. Now, of course, the Old Testament, like I said, all of the Old Testament talks about Jesus. And right here in Isaiah is talking about Jesus. And this is exactly what's happening. This is what they've done to him. And he said he didn't say a word. It was prophesied that he wouldn't say anything. Now let's go back to Matthew 26, verses 63 and 64. Again, but Jesus held his peace, and the high priest answered and said unto him, I assure thee by the living God that thou tellest whether thou be the Christ, the Son of God. Now the high priest is getting angry here, because everything they've tried to do to prove that he was guilty of whatever has fell through. So now they're trying to just get him to condemn himself. Now since they couldn't do it, now they're trying to get him to say, are you the Christ? Are you the Son of God? And now right here, Jesus does break his silence. Hoping that they'll see that he is the Son of God. He's giving them a chance to repent before they go any further. Because remember, these religious leaders, they've not only is Jesus saying who he is, but they've seen the miracles. miracles. And even though they didn't like it, they were angry, but they were in the flesh. They were angry because they couldn't do them. These religious leaders did no miracles. Nowhere in the Bible you find these religious leaders did miracles. All right, so now they're getting angry. Verse 64, Jesus saith unto him, Thou hast said, Nevertheless I say unto you, Hereafter shall ye see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. And in Mark, he makes it even clearer. Right here he's saying he is, but in Mark 14:62, it says, And Jesus said, I am. And you shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. Now the Jews knew the scriptures. They knew the scriptures. They knew who the I am is. Just like when they went to go, when those soldiers came to arrest him in John 18:6, when they went to arrest him, which we talked about this last week, as soon, John 18:6, as soon then as he had said unto them, they said, We're looking for Jesus, Jesus of Nazareth, and Jesus said, I am he is what Jesus said. They went backward and fell to the ground. Now, why do you think they fell backwards and fell to the ground?
You're talking about the
religious soldiers. The soldiers, when Jesus said, who are you looking for? And Jesus said, I am. He said, I am he. And it says that, and the scriptures say that when as soon as he said that, the soldiers fell on the ground.
They realized who he was.
Like I just said, the Jews know the scriptures. Yeah. They know the scriptures. And so when he said, I am, Exodus 3:14, it says, And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you. So when he said, I am, they knew who he was talking about. Also in Matthew 25, when the Son of Man, which he said right here back in Mark 14:62, when the Son of Man, speaking of himself, shall come in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd separateth his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand and put the goats on the left. Now Jesus is saying, not only am I the Messiah, the Son of God, but one day you will see me in my glory. And then who's going to be doing the judging? Right now you're judging me. But one day I'm coming back, Son of Man, Son of God, the Messiah, the Christ, and he will separate the sheep from the goats. Now who's the sheep?
Christians.
The Christians. The goats are those who don't know him. So he's going to come and separate them. That's what Jesus is going to do. And then he's going to be doing the judging. And that's what he's telling these religious leaders right here. Remember, the scriptures say if two or more witness something that is right or wrong, then the judge is to take it, right? We learned that last week. But right here, Jesus is saying, I am the Son of God. All right? This is what Jesus is saying. Now, in Matthew 27, verses 3 and 4, this is Judas. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself. Now, this doesn't mean he repented and got saved. He was just he was in regret on what he did. And brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. Now, what Judas is saying right here, I have been wrong. I have betrayed this man who claims to be true. He is Son of God. He is the Messiah. That's what he's saying right here. And the religious leader, and they said, What is that to do with us? See thou to that. But right here we got Judas saying, Yes, he is the Son of God. Yes, he is the Messiah. Then you got Jesus saying the same thing. All right? So if you got two witnesses, right, they're supposed to accept it. But what did they tell Judas? They said, What is that to us? They have Jesus saying who he is. They have Judas saying, Yes, this is innocent blood. He is the Messiah. But what did they do with this witnessing? They said it. What is that to do with us? It's like, we don't want to hear it. They totally ignored what they had. So that witnessing, them being witness to this, means absolutely nothing to them. Now back in Mark chapter 14, 63, let me go back to John 18, 6. These Jews fell back when Jesus said, I am he, and the Jews fell back. They knew who Jesus was. Not only the soldiers, the religious leaders. They knew. They know the scriptures. The Jews know the scriptures, especially the Old Testament. They know them by heart. But not only did they knew, but did they obey them? Did they live them? They had it all here. I wanted to point this out. The Jews had it all here. Because right now, even right now, the Jews know the scriptures, know the Old Testament a whole lot better than we do.
Yeah, they could have. You know, other soldiers could have spoke up too.
They could have, but you didn't go up against the religious leaders. Yeah. That was law there. You didn't do that. But what I'm trying to show you, people know it here, but they don't obey it, and they don't live it. And this is what we saw in these verses right here. These Jews knew who Jesus was, and the way we know that is because they fell on the ground. But did they live a Christian life? Did they obey the Lord? And do we still have that today? A lot of people have them here, but they're 18 inches away from having it for real. And I'm talking about the heart. They don't have them in the heart. They know all about them here, but they don't have them in the heart. And this is where the Jews were. They knew about them, but they didn't have them. They didn't accept them. Now, Mark 14, verse 63, then the high priest rent his clothes and saith, what need we any further witness? Now, the high priest sinned. He sinned right here. Again, the high priest sinned right here by tearing off his clothes. Because in the Old Testament, Leviticus 21:10, it says, and he that is the high priest among his brethren, upon whose head the anointing oil was poured, and that is concentrated to put on the garments, shall not uncover his head nor rent his clothes. So right here in the Old Testament, it said the high priest should not tear his clothes. But right here, I'm showing you again, again, and again. They keep doing stuff that is against the scriptures. These priests, these religious leaders, they just keep on over and over breaking the law. Breaking their own laws. Breaking the laws of God. That's how bad they want to put him to death. They're breaking their own laws. They're breaking the scriptures so they can put Jesus to death. This priest tore his clothes off. And right here, it was known in the Old Testament that priests don't do that. It's the word of God says, do not do this. And he did it. These religious leaders just over and over and over keep going against the scriptures. Now, Matthew 26, 65 through 68, it says it again. Then the high priest rent his clothes, saying, he has spoken blasphemy. What further need have we of witness? Behold, now ye have heard his blasphemy. Again, they're being illegal, because if you remember what it says in Deuteronomy, chapter 17, verse 6, by the mouth of two or more witnesses. You got to have two or more witnesses. But what did they say further up? They didn't want to hear what Judas had to say. So they're completely ignoring that. So Jesus can't be a witness of himself, because that's only one. And they're ignoring Judas. They say, we don't want to hear what you have to say. Now, they're being so... Now, I'll show you how ridiculous this trial is. You go... They bring me before the judge. And the judge asks me, are you Jesse? And I say, yes, I am. The judge says, you need to be put to death. I mean, that's what they're doing right here. That's exactly what they're doing. If you look at the whole picture, I mean, this is what they're doing. He's just agreeing, yes, this is who I am. And now they want to put him to death for who he is. Even though it's illegal, Everything they have against him is illegal. Blasphemy here means he's going against, they looked at it, he's going against the Christ, because they don't believe he was the Christ. They believe he's disrespecting the Christ. So they're calling it blasphemy. And blasphemy, apparently you can put him to death for that. These religious leaders had already decided and had already rejected him long before this trial. So anything that is said in this trial, if it's right and it proves Jesus to be who he is, they're rejecting it, just like I said before. They're even throwing false witnesses out there to get Jesus. Before this trial even started, they had already decided he was guilty and they were gonna kill him. This is what they wanted. They didn't even investigate. You know, on the trial, you investigate. Okay, you claim to be this. Well, let's see. What did you do? Or blah, 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 you know. But they didn't do any of this. They already had him condemned before the trial even started. Even though he had done all these miracles, and like I said, they saw the miracles. Even though they saw him do all these miracles, that right there should have been enough to show them this is the Son of God. But they ignored all that. They ignored John the Baptist. Verse 66. What think ye? They answered and said, he is guilty of death. Then did they spit in his face, buffet him, and others smote him with the palms of their hands, saying, prophesy unto us, thou Christ, who is he that smote thee? Now, does this even sound like a court? They're in court, and they're hitting them and saying, who hit you? And the reason they say, who hit you, is because in Luke 22:64, it says that he was blindfolded. It doesn't say it here, but in Luke it does. It said he was blindfolded. So they hit him. He was blindfolded. They hit him, and they said, who hit you? Now, this is court. Or at this time right here. Now, this is a court. They're in court, and they're acting this way. Tell us who hit you. They spit on him. Is this court? I mean, was this really a trial? Nothing here is a trial. Nothing here was justice. Nothing. As I've been reading everything we've read, I've showed you where it's all illegal. Not only illegal in the law, but illegal in God's words. Now we're going to continue in the next morning. In Matthew 27, we're going to see what happened the next morning. Because this was all done at night, remember. So the next morning, in Matthew 27:1, when the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. But they couldn't put him to death. The Jews couldn't put Jesus to death because the Romans they were under bondage of the Romans. All right? The Romans took that privilege away from them, that they could kill anybody in their courts. The Romans took that away. And even though they did that a few months after they did crucify Jesus, a few months after that, they did stone Stephen to death. The Jewish people. So they weren't really obeying even the Roman laws. They did to a point. But like I said, about a few months after Jesus, they stoned Stephen to death. In fact, they stoned many of the disciples to death. And they couldn't do that. And this right here is why they're taking Jesus to the Roman leaders. So they could put him to death. Because they wasn't supposed to. Now in John 18:28, then led they Jesus from the high priest unto the hall of judgment. And it was early. And they themselves went not into the judgment hall, lest they should be defiled, but that they might eat the Passover. Now they didn't go into the courtyard because it was Passover weekend, and they had to be clean to prepare the meal. Passover was very important to the Jews. In fact, one day, if the Lord leads me, I'll teach exactly what Passover means. Exactly. But it was right before it was the weekend of the Passover, so they found to be in the Romans' place, in their house or in their courts, would defile them. Because they looked at the Romans as being lost people. That they were right with God, but they were lost. So they felt they would be defiled if they went in there. So here they brought Jesus over there and brought Jesus in there, but they wouldn't go into the house. Now, if you was Pilate, oh, you bring this man to me, but you won't even come in? I mean, that's pretty much them showing Pilate, hey, you know, your place is dirty. Talking about not right with the Lord. Okay? But they're wanting Pilate to do this for them. But they won't even go into their courts because they feel they're unclean people. Now, what hypocrites we have. Here they are. Totally, everything is against the law. The Jewish law is what they did. Against the Son of God. They want to kill him, which is murder. Thou shalt not kill. Another Ten Commandment. I mean, these Jews were just really just going totally out of their way to put Jesus to death. But they obeyed everything else. The Sabbath day. Oh, they held the Sabbath day to the T. Oh, you can't do anything. They kept that law like, I mean, that was right there equal with God. That's how serious they took that. But then they did all this. Everything they did was illegal. Illegal. They did this illegal, but over here they would say, work on the Sabbath day? Ooh, that's bad. That is very sinful. You see what I'm saying? I mean, these are just plain hypocrites. Over here they say this, but then over here they say, oh, well, you know, you can't do that. But you're wrong for this, which is this big, but something little. Oh, don't, you know, we can't do that. That's the Sabbath day. Well, we can lie about this man. We can lie about this man and have a legal trial against him. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They obeyed what they wanted to obey. Y'all hear me?
Yeah.
They obeyed what they wanted to obey. Just like today.
Yeah.
We read the Bible, and many people, oh, yeah, that's okay. I'll obey that. But if they run across something that they don't like, they ignore it. They ignore it. They disobey it. We do it the same thing today. So we really can't look too down at this religious leaders, because even today's Christians, they do the same thing. We seem to pick what we like and say, yes, I obey. But things we don't like, we ignore. I'm serious. Y'all see what I'm saying? Jews, these leaders did the same thing. They ignored all this because this is what they wanted.
Right.
But this little thing over here, oh, we need to follow this. We as Christians do the same thing today. We have things that we'll obey, but we'll have scriptures. We disobey them. We ignore them, but that's disobeying them. These religious leaders, they were stuck on themselves. You know, they didn't even preach to people. All they did was condemn people. They didn't preach to people. You read the New Testament, and you won't find where these religious leaders were preaching to the people. All they did was condemn them. All you have to do is read the New Testament, and you'll see that. All they wanted to do was argue with each other. Like I told you before, the three main religions got together. The Sadducees, the Pharisees, and the Scribes. There were three religions that did not get along because they had different beliefs. But they got together. They got together so they could put Jesus to death. But their main thing was to argue with each other. They didn't even pay attention to the people. They spent most of their time arguing against each other. When you read the Bible, you'll see that. In fact, they wouldn't even go into a lost person's home. If you didn't know the Lord, they wouldn't even go into your home. Where Jesus went to go eat with the sinners, remember? And they said that he goes into the house of the sinners. He even eats with them. It's like, to them it was like, that is wrong. That is wrong. What are you doing eating with a sinner? Christians eat with sinners. We eat with sinners so we can tell them about our Lord. Not just to join them and party and do what they do. Jesus went in there so he was able to witness to them. To show them who is the Son of God. What it is to be a Christian. But these religious leaders were too good to go visit lost people. They wouldn't even go into their house. They didn't go into the Roman's house. They wouldn't even go into a Jew's house if he was not right with God. Is that the way we're supposed to be as Christians? Just like Jesus was saying and showing in Matthew 23 that I read last week, that there were these people, these religious leaders, were clean on the outside, but they had dead men bones on the inside. They were real religious on the outside, but had dead men bones on the inside. That's what Jesus said. Now I have to say, we're not too far different from them. They're pretty hypocritical, but so are Christians today. When we're in church or we're around Christians, we do the Christian thing, act Christian. But then when we get around lost people who are not born again, who are lost, we fit right on in with them. So when we're with lost people, we can fit in with them. When we're with Christians, we fit in with them. Do you understand what I'm saying? So that's just as hypocritical as the religious leaders. Think about it. When we're Christians, that's 24/7. No matter who you're around, doesn't matter. You're a Christian 24/7. When you're with nothing but lost people, that doesn't mean you can act like a lost person. Christians is a 24/7. But we have many today who do exactly that. Now, you think that's pleasing to the Lord? The Lord says, if you're going to be lukewarm, if you're going to ride the fence, He said, I'd rather just spit you out of my mouth. You're Christian when you're around Christians. You act like a lost when you're with lost. You're riding the fence. He says, the Lord said, I hate that so much, I'd rather just spit you out of my mouth than have you that way. He says, either be a Christian or don't be a Christian. That's what the Lord says. These religious leaders, that's what they did. They were so hypocritical. Verse 29. Pilate then went out unto them and said, what accusation bring ye against this man? They answered and said unto him, if he were not a malefactor, meaning evildoer, we would not have delivered him unto thee. Then it goes to Luke 23:2. And they began to accuse him, saying, we found this fellow perverting the nation. Meaning, they said that Jesus was perverting the nation. And he was talking about overthrowing Rome. That's what they're saying here. And forbidden to give tribute to Caesar, saying that he himself is Christ, a king. Now they were lying to the Roman judge. They were lying to him. Because in Luke 20:25, it says, and he said unto them, this is what Jesus was saying. Jesus said, render therefore unto Caesar the things which are to be Caesar's, and unto God the things which be of God. So is he trying to get the people not to pay their taxes? No, Jesus was saying, if it's Caesar's image on the cone, then give Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give the Lord what belongs to the Lord. So right here they were saying that he was telling them not to pay the taxes. So these religious leaders now lying to the Romans just to get a to have him put to death. Remember, in their own trial, he was accused of blasphemy. But now they have changed it to three different accusations. First, they had said blasphemy, but now they changed it to three different things. And the reason they had changed it was because blasphemy is not a law-breaking charge of death. So they couldn't go in there saying blasphemy, because the Romans didn't see that as a put-to-death charge. That's why come they came up with these three that they give right here. They knew that if they could show he was proclaiming to be king, okay, now they got the Romans' attention. Now that would be a charge, that if he was claiming to be a king, now that would be a charge that was a charge of put-to-death for the Romans. So this way they could win if they say, well, he's proclaiming to be a king. Now back to John 18, verse 31. Then said Pilate unto them, take ye him, and judge him according to your law. The Jews therefore said unto him, it is not lawful for us to put any man to death. Remember I told you earlier? They can't put no one to death. But pretty much what Pilate is saying is that he doesn't believe him. He's got to take care of this, you know. He's like, I'm not taking this, what you're saying. Now, just 4 months before this, they were breaking the Roman laws. In John chapter 10, verse 24 through 33, and then verse 39, it says, then came the Jews round about him and said unto him, how long dost thou make us to doubt, if thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But ye believe me not, because you are not of my sheep, as I said unto you. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Let me just stop right there real quick. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. Do we have Christians that way today? Some. The Beatitudes that I just did, this is what's following the Lord. Those of you who heard the Beatitudes, this is what's following the Lord. Not going to church on Sunday, that's not following the Lord. Going to church on Sunday, that's a man religious thing. Because in the Bible, there is no certain day you're supposed to go to church. Every day is the Lord's day. Every day. The Sabbath, that's a day of rest. That's not a holy day like we make it to be. Y'all hear what I'm saying? My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. They don't follow the religious leaders. They don't go to church every Sunday and think that makes them right with the Lord. They follow the Lord. This is the Lord, the Word of God. Alright? Verse 28. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Then the Jews took up stones against to stone him. Jesus answered them, Many good works have I showed you from my Father. For which of those works do ye stone me? And the Jews answered him, saying, For a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy. And because thou, being a man, makest thyself God. Verse 39, Therefore thou sought again to take him, but he escaped out of their hand. Now right here, like I said, this was just 4 months before this trial. They were ready to stone him. They were ready to stone him here. This is 4 months before the trial. But right here it says, but he got away from them. But he says, they were ready to stone him. Knowing it was against Romans law. But now they won't. Now they won't stone him. And it's because what it says in Matthew's 21:46, but when they sought to lay hands on him, they feared the multitude because they took him for a prophet. So within that 4 months, what happened was they took Jesus as a prophet. Now, what's it going to look like? You got religious leaders stoning a prophet to the people. They knew that the people would go against them. If they believed, the people believed Jesus to be a prophet. That's what they believed. That's what it says right here. So how's it going to look? The religious leaders stoning a prophet. So 4 months before this, it was okay. But in those 4 months, Jesus had a big following. So now they look at him as a prophet. So now they couldn't stone him. They couldn't stone him.
Oh, because since they saw everybody following him, they considered
him
a prophet.
Yeah, they because of the miracles and how he fed the thousands, and they looked at him as a prophet. As a prophet. Not as the Messiah, not as the Christ, not as the Son of God, a prophet. What's a prophet? A prophet is just a man. A man of God. But they... So this is why they wouldn't stone him now. Because of what the people believed.
Oh, okay.
So like I said, 4 months ago, they were ready to stone him. Because they didn't have that big a following.
Yeah.
But since then, his following had multiplied. Mm-hmm. So now they couldn't stone him. Now in John 18, 33 and 34. Then Pilate entered into the judgment hall again and called Jesus and said on him, Art thou the king of the Jews? Pilate knew that Jesus wasn't trying to overtake Rome. Pilate knew that. You know, the Jews lived among the Romans. And believe me, the governor, the Roman leader, they knew everything the Jews were doing. They knew everything that was going on. And Pilate knew that Jesus wasn't trying to overtake Rome. He also knew he wasn't trying to keep the people from paying their taxes. But he did have to investigate, you know, you're proclaiming to be a king. This he had to look into, because this went against Caesar. Now that he did have to look into. Verse 34, Jesus answered him, Sayest thou this thing of thyself, or did others tell it thee of me? So what Jesus is saying, are you wanting to know for yourself, or you're just asking but because this is what people have told you? Are you being yourself, or are you being a judge? So the reason he said that is because he says, you know, if you're being yourself, then Pilate is wanting to know, hey, are you the Messiah? Are you the Son of God? And if he would have asked him not as a judge, then Jesus would have told him. You know, Jesus would have witnessed to him right there on the spot. And this is why Jesus asked him, are you asking for yourself? Or are you saying it because this is what people have told you? Is it personal? If it's personal, let me witness to you. That's what Jesus was meaning. Verse 35, Pilate answered, am I a Jew? Thy own nation and chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done? Pilate says, I'm not interested in you or your religion, for I'm not a Jew. So Pilate's saying, I'm not a Jew. I'm not interested in any of that. So what he's saying is, he is a judge and he's just doing his job. He needs to investigate why he's proclaiming to be a king, or why they're saying he's proclaiming to be a king. Verse 36. Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence. Jesus is saying, my kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. This is what Jesus is telling. My kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. If it was, he said, my soldiers would have gone to battle. When they came to have gotten me, my soldiers would have fought for me, instead of letting the religious leaders take them to kill them. This is what he's saying right here. And in Matthew 26, verses 52 and 53, it says, then Jesus said unto him, when they came to arrest Jesus, what did Peter do? Took his sword and cut off soldier's ear, right? Okay, Jesus said unto him, talking to Peter, put up away thy sword into his place, for all they that take the sword shall perish with the sword. Thinkest thou that I cannot pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? So, what Jesus said, my kingdom is not here. If my kingdom was here, then my men would fight for me. He said, but I'm not of this world. My kingdom is not here. He said, if it was, I could have called 12 legions of angels. 12 legions of angels is like 4,000 to 6,000 angels. And Jesus could have done this. He said he could have done this. Now, if his kingdom was of this world and he was trying to take over the kingdom, this world, to be his kingdom, then all he had to do was call out down 12 legions of angels. But he said he didn't do that. He didn't do it because his kingdom is not of this world. Now, the high priest, and like I said a while ago, these soldiers, when Peter did cut off the ear of the soldier, now the high priest and the other soldiers saw Jesus pick up the ear and heal, put it back on and healed him right there on the spot. His ear was put back on just like it had never been cut off. Now, this high priest was there. These soldiers were there. And that right there, their heart was so hard-hearted that they couldn't look at that and see that Jesus was the Messiah, the Christ. I mean, if someone comes to me right now and they cut my ear off, and then the man next to him picks it up and puts it back on, ain't that going to do something to you? Who is this? But the religious leaders had such a hold on the people. Now listen to me. The soldiers saw Jesus put the ear back on, healed it completely, not just glued it or taped it up there. He healed it. When Jesus did something, he did it right. He healed the man's ear. He put his ear back on. We see miracles today. We see miracles today. That right there should have, especially the high priest, should have known this is the Messiah. Them themselves should have fell to the ground. Now the soldiers did. It said the soldiers did. But right there, the high priest right there should have saw something. I mean, Jesus right there in front of them showed them who he was by what he did. We have that today. Jesus is revealing himself to everyone. Somehow, some way, he reveals himself to everyone. And a lot of people are reacting just like the high priest did here, like it was nothing. You hear what I'm saying? He acted like it was nothing. They just reacted in the flesh. They didn't take it. They didn't look at it spiritually or nothing. They just completely ignored what Jesus did. But like I said, let's don't look too down on the religious leaders, because I'm making the religious leaders, not me. I'm not making them sound this way. The scriptures is making them sound pretty bad. But like I said, we can't look down at these religious leaders, because somehow, some way, in our lives today, we act the same way they do. And this is what we're learning. This is what we're learning from this teaching. Now, I'm not finished with it, but I still got another part. But what I'm showing right now is this teaching. Not only are we learning about the trial of Jesus, but this teaching is also teaching us, hey, am I going to be as dumb as those religious leaders? When I see or hear the word of God, am I going to react? You hear what I'm saying? Jesus also says, but now is my kingdom not from hence. Meaning right now my kingdom is not here. But there's going to be a time when I'm coming with my army. And who's the army?
Christians.
The Christians, the saints. We're his army. I taught you in the teaching of the last days. I taught you that we're his saints. And we're going to be coming with him. He said, then I will make my kingdom on the earth. But he said, not right now. But there is a day coming. Amen. There is a day coming when Jesus will be king. I just get so emotional because I know this is the word of God. I know how true that is. My Father, my Lord, my everything, one day will be king over everything. And these stupid religious leaders will not be doing the judge anymore.